so let's get on to our speaker. As I said before, I don't know if you followed the stories in Oklahoma, but in the past, there's been a monument to the Ten Commandments, the Ten Commandments on Capitol grounds that was paid for privately, but the legislature allowed this to happen. And I think there's an ACLU court case right now on that. But in the meantime, another group has come and said, okay, well, if you guys can have this, then we want a statue too. And that was the Satanic Temple. And that has, not surprisingly, caused a stink. I'm very delighted to have Lucien Greaves, the spokesperson for the Satanic Temple, here today to talk to us about that. So.
Thank you. It's good to see all of you here, especially Scott, I must say, because he's one person who's followed me from my more academic writings when I've written things for Skeptic and Skeptical Inquirer, and then moved into this, and I'm not sure still where I stand with all that, but to some people, I think, who followed me before and liked what I was doing, I've become rather untouchable, which is kind of painful, but I think what we're doing is very important, and eventually everybody will come to understand it. It may look entirely like pranksterism in a good time, but as one of our co-founders said, when we fuck around, we don't fuck around. And it's mostly atheist groups who've ever invited me to speak, which isn't entirely surprising because satanic organizations have been almost entirely politically irrelevant or lacking an agenda. And most people don't even know they've actually existed, but they have. But our ideas of what Satanism actually is always derived from pejorative labels put upon outgroups by witch hunters, essentially. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that, but I will get to the monument question. But being an atheistic Satanist, I think, is an important thing. I do these interviews sometimes, and the question comes up, the idea that I can't possibly call myself religious, but be an atheist. And I know a lot of atheist groups have a knee-jerk negative response to the word religion. And I think that that's a mistake. We're allowing the other side to define what religion means. When I have Alan Colmes yelling at me or Laura Ingraham and saying that you can't call yourself religion unless you subscribe to a superstition, I think that's not true, nor could it possibly be true and also be a constitutional point of view. Because then you're actually giving people privileges and exemptions for superstition rather than non-belief. I think you should hold to the fact that atheism is not a religion. Atheism is too broad a category. What we're doing, we take the metaphorical construct of Satanism and we use this to define our works and goals, but our tenets, what we drive for, those we truly believe in, we truly value. And we were in, you're talking about the fund for abortion. People who need help with the abortions or whatever else. With Roe versus Wade not being overturned, you now see a religious agenda using all kinds of other tactics to try to dissuade women from abortion. And we find laws like the transvaginal ultrasound encroaching into this whole discussion, trying to make it untenable for a woman to be able to get an abortion by this kind of invasive, superfluous procedure. Well, our thinking is, and now we're registered as an LLC, we'll be able to do this kind of thing. We register as an LLC because we're not accepting tax-exempt status. We think churches should pay their taxes. That's something they can stand on there. Otherwise, we'll follow their footsteps and push it in whatever way. But one of the tenets we wrote is that the body is inviolable, subject to one's own will alone. And on those grounds, we want to take further actions and put things to the test, like this, where we have a waiver and that a woman can sign that will say that since she subscribes to our tenets, she shouldn't be subject to a transvaginal ultrasound. In that way, we're offering a counterbalance, and in that way, we think the metaphor of Satan is perfect as the ultimate rebel against the tyranny of arbitrary authority. But first, I wanted to start out and tell you a little bit about what, where your ideas of Satanism might have come from, if you have that kind of knee-jerk reaction where you think that it's just silliness to take on the icon of absolute cruelty and evil associated with infant sacrifice, cannibalism, and those kinds of things. In 1980, a book came out, it's called Michelle Remembers. Does anybody know about this? It was actually a bestseller, and it was promoted on in People Weekly, National Enquirer, that the authors ended up on Oprah and Sarah Jessica Raphael, Geraldo, all those kinds of talk shows. And the idea was that this this woman, Michelle Smith, went into therapy with her therapist, the Lord's pastor. They were both Catholic, and he did some 600 hours of hypnosis on her, regressed her so that she recalled these memories of satanic abuse. Very particularly Catholic type of satanic abuse, because that plays into, it's very obvious where they're coming from there. But they told this grotesque story of child abuse and infant mutilation and ritual sacrifice and that kind of thing. And it titillated them to the point where they married each other. These sessions. But at some point, journalists went and looked at the mundane details given in this book and began debunking them. She said there was like some 180-day ritual ceremony she was involved in a cemetery near her house. And this seemed untenable because it was in a very kind of public area near a roadway, that kind of thing. And they eventually just debunked this book almost entirely. But the amazing part is that this was necessary at all, because part of the story is that she was abused by Satan himself. And none other than Jesus Christ comes down, removes her scars, and thus the corroborating evidence that anything happened to her at all. And it, somewhere after that is where you get this quote from Lawrence Pastor. It is a real experience. If you say that, if you talk to Michelle today, she will say, "That's what I remember." We still leave the question open. For her, it was very real. Every case I hear, I have skepticism. You have to complete a long course of therapy before you can come to conclusions. We are all eager to prove or disprove what happened, but in the end, it doesn't matter. And this is kind of the mantra that these people held to, that, it, that reality doesn't matter, there's a personal reality, while at the same time, during the recovered memory, this whole scandal, people were going to prison for accusations based upon people's private conception of reality that they had recovered under hypnosis. And I don't know if you're aware of this whole event. It's what sociologists refer to today as the Satanic Panic. But it's no different at all from, in evidentiary standards, from the alien abduction phenomenon. And you'll hear different stories about the idea of repressed trauma, where they'll say, well, you can't fake real trauma. You know, there's a difference between abduction trauma, so-called trauma, and real ritual abuse trauma, you know, this sexual abuse that is so uniquely traumatic that you forget all about it. And that too isn't true. At Harvard, they did psychophysiological testing on subjects, script-driven narrative readings, where they brought in people who were abducted by aliens. They thought they were abducted by aliens. And they truly believe this. They were regressed back. And I've talked to these people. I've mingled with both crowds. I've talked to the people abducted by aliens. I've talked to the people ritually abused by Satanists. And I must say, I definitely prefer the alien abduction crowd. they're far more open to reason, actually, or to a different narrative, in any case. The satanic abuse crowd is very vitriolic. And if you doubt their story at all, well, first, if you're arguing with them, they're a very insular kind of group. They're used to their therapy type groups. This whole kind of survivor movement was born after Sybil and Michelle Remembers. Sybil was probably you probably know about that. That one's more popular. The Woman with the 16 Personalities. You might not know that that book was entirely debunked also. In fact, I mean, Nathan released a book last year or the year before, Sybil Exposed, where it went through the notes and the old letters that had been archived between the patient, Sybil, and her therapist. And it was quite obvious that they had contrived the story because it was very, very sensational, and that other doctors didn't agree with this diagnosis. And the whole multiple personality disorder thing falls apart, but not before it causes this entire moral panic. And another follow-up book that came out was it was Satan's Underground by Lawrence Stratford. And this is a recent review on Google. So it says, Lawrence Stratford's story is one that everyone needs to read, though it deals with a subject most of us would rather not discuss, a subject that for many is too horrendous to even believe. And that's kind of a common theme, not just with the satanic ritual abuse crowd, the ones who say that this kind of thing happens, but with conspiracy theory in general. That if you don't believe their narrative, it's because you have the rosy-colored glasses on. You don't want to see the world in this sinister light, and they have this kind of superior ability to see things for what they are because they can accept that this horrific thing is actually happening around them. Where in reality, you see that they have a very tidy narrative that makes things very cut and dry for them. Everything is divided, good against evil, and they have a common enemy that they can destroy. And this leads to very destructive practices. This leads to witch hunts. And the satanic panic spawned by Michelle Remembers and Satan's Underground, it was definitely a witch hunt. And people, there was a case, Fran and Dan Keller, they just got out of prison about a month ago, and the crimes they were convicted of were essentially supernatural crimes. They couldn't possibly have been true. And Satan's Underground, for its part, absolutely was not true. It was debunked thoroughly to the point where the publisher withdrew it, and it was a Christian magazine, actually, Cornerstone, that went, sought her out, interviewed her parents, neighbors, that kind of thing, found that there was no corroborating evidence for claims of her medical condition. She claimed she'd been a doctor for different things like that. That made the story fall apart, but there again, being a supernatural tale, you'd think it wouldn't need that kind of debunking. And I'm always amazed. Did you see the Ken Ham Bill Nye debate?
Yes.
Yeah, I just, you know, I get kind of isolated myself, I guess, within my own network of people. But it seems surreal to me for a moment that you had a public advocate of science feeling the need, or there actually being the need for him to stand there and debunk Noah's Ark in front of adults, grown people, and he's explaining how this couldn't possibly be the case. And That's still a national issue. But in any case, Lauren Stratford, she left the whole survivor of ritual abuse scene to go off and pretend to be a Holocaust survivor. She was found doing that under a different name. So when these people ask the question, why would somebody lie about such a thing? You know, just have to ask, I don't know, why do they? But this all came together with the McMartin preschool scandal. And there was a whole scandal of daycare ritual abuse claims where there's a lot of different theories as to why this took place. For one thing, daycares were becoming more prevalent, and people felt that they were losing a hold of the nuclear family. And there was also a certain faction of feminism that felt that if you denied any claim of abuse, you were only helping perpetrators of abuse. And there's no middle ground. If somebody says they were abused, no matter how unlikely the claim, if it involves robots and flying carpets, as it did in McMartin, it's no joke. They actually, the kids were making these kinds of claims, but the kids were put under this intense scrutiny. And they'd be asked for hours at a time to contrive these stories. And now, one of the kids even wrote a thing for the Los Angeles Times, I think in 2005, where he wanted to issue his apology to the McMartin school people who ended up having such a horrible time. It was a 7-year, $15 million trial, this massively expensive trial that ruined their lives, but they weren't convicted ultimately. Now the story is only used pretty much as in the academic setting as a really kind of a marker for prosecutorial misconduct. The prosecutor withheld evidence, and it was just, the whole thing was a disaster. But anyways, this all, some moral panic. Oh yeah, here's a quote from the kid who grew up and wrote the thing Los Angeles Times in 2005. He said, "Never did anyone do anything to me, and I never saw them doing anything. I said lots of things that didn't happen. I lied. Anytime I would give them an answer that they didn't like, they would ask again and encourage me to give the answer that they were looking for. I felt uncomfortable and a little ashamed that I was being dishonest. But at the same time, being the type of person I was, whatever my parents wanted me to do, I would do it." But he's probably one of the lucky ones. You get kids, say, 3 years old or whatever, and memory is a reconstructive process, and you have somebody beating this idea into your head that you were raped and abused and molested and, you know, under satanic assault all the time. You're probably going to believe it. And those are the really unlucky ones, is the kids who grow up believing that. And they're still around. And I think this, if I remember correctly, he was a little bit older than the one in the preschool. He was there for another purpose, being used more as a daycare or something. So he had already gotten his head kind of in order, so he had reliable memory perhaps at that point. But what was interesting, then, you have this moral satanic panic, and you had this kind of interplay where you had these expectations of what the satanic is, and then you get a few people picking up on that, using that as a framework to describe their own anti-human acts. And, you know, Richard Ramirez, the serial killer, carving the pentagram in his hand. Goes, you know, he's all in the name of Satan. And there was another really interesting case of a kid, Sean Sellers. He was 16 years old, and he murdered his parents. And before that, 3 months earlier, he got away with murdering a convenience store operator. And the talk shows went nuts. He was happy to blame Satanism, but what was really interesting about it was the lack of any critical thinking whatsoever. The immediate question should have been, of course, who were the other people Sean Sellers was involved with? They're claiming that this had something to do with the satanic cult conspiracy, but never did the question come up. What cult was he involved in? Where were these other people? He never even claimed there were any. He was obviously looking at this from a supernatural perspective. He grew up in Oklahoma, and he was obviously had a religious upbringing, and he got the idea, I guess, that what he had done must have been of Satan. He probably had no explanation for it himself. He had read the Satanic Bible. Nobody could say where his ideas had come from. He confessed they were an amalgamation of things he himself had put together, yet on Geraldo specials and things like that, they contrived this whole narrative of this conspiracy. And this was a time, you know, this crass conspiracy theory was very prevalent. People would talk about it in very serious terms. And they would get together and, you know, law enforcement would have seminars run by some of these bogus therapists who would talk about commonalities amongst occult criminals and that kind of thing. All completely imaginary and sending them down the wrong path if they want to take care of real problems in the real world, but there they go nonetheless.
Deals with devil worship and satanic beliefs. It contains explicit scenes and descriptions of violent crimes and rituals. Because of the program's theme and controversial subject matter, parental discretion should be exercised.
You have to give a blood sacrifice to Satan. It's supposed to keep you protected. It's supposed to keep you pure.
They said that if we told that the devil would come and kill our parents,
it doesn't matter if you believe in Satan. It doesn't matter if you believe in demons. What's important is to know that there are people out there that do, and that are willing to do anything to accomplish their goal.
Satanism is more than a hodgepodge of mysticism and fantasy, more than a Halloween motif. It's a violent impulse. It preys on the emotionally vulnerable, especially teenagers. often lonely and lost.
It basically started out like with the killing of animals. Then there's always the heavy metal music and drugs don't help.
It attracts the angry and the powerless, who often think it's a secret lie.
They asked me if I had ever thought about killing somebody just to watch them die. And they asked me if I would like to join a satanic cult.
Yeah, this genius is part of a movement that's never been detected.
And yet, heavy metal, rock and roll. Often, Satanism seems to be a personal psychodrama, a kind of license for strange, sometimes violent behavior.
A bloodbath would be a cleansing and purification of a planet that has been dirtied and degraded for too long.
Sometimes it's just half-baked mumbo-jumbo and scrawled symbols. But other times it goes deeper, deadly.
Tommy died as brutally as his mother did, but at his own hands.
I loved him dearly, but he also took my wife who I loved.
Satanism goes far beyond teenage obsession. Today there are cults that worship the devil, engage in secret ceremonies, believe in ancient, though bizarre, theology. All of it constitutionally protected, as long as no laws are broken.
I believe that hate is necessary in a controlled way just as much as love is necessary.
The other face of adult Satanism is violent and fiendish, centered on sexual ritual and torture, frequently descending into the vilest crime of all, sexual abuse of children.
He has drawn pictures of a child being sacrificed. He's talked about animal sacrifices. He's disclosed molestation.
And what of their own children? Some are born into satanic cults and grow up as lifelong members. Others are desperate to flee, but dread the penalty of grotesque death.
They're going to catch me. It don't matter. I could run and run and run. They're always going to catch me because they're all over.
And beyond the mayhem and monsters, it's said that a nationwide network of satanic criminals exists. Start with the warped and wicked Charles Manson.
It's everything that human beings don't understand. It's all their fears. It's what they're not sure of. You dig what I'm saying? Satan to me would be God.
Or the demented Son of Sam killer David Berkowitz. These and others purportedly linked to the devil worship underground.
It is Satan.
It's all over the United States and probably all over the world because it's just something that people are experimenting with now.
Impossible to measure. Easy to doubt. The very mention of it invites ridicule.
Come out.
No, I won't let her go. No.
Often the choice is to avoid confronting it, ignore it, find other explanations, or laugh it off. That is not the choice we have made tonight. We have chosen to ask why. Via satellite, we'll be asking the youngest person on Oklahoma's death row, just 17 when he killed in the name of Satan, why he murdered his own parents. And to Southern California, where we will ask the parents of children in the notorious McMartin preschool why they claim their kids were satanically abused. And to London, where rock star Ozzy Osbourne will tell us why he feels he and heavy metal music are getting a bum rap. And to the state penitentiary in Angola, Louisiana, to ask convicted killer Charles Gervais why he thought the devil would award him 10,000 souls. Whether a Satan exists is a matter of belief, but we are certain that Satanism exists. To some, it's a religion. To others, it's the practice of evil in the devil's name. It exists, and it's flourishing. Members of our studio audience tonight will attest to that. They are friends and foes of Satanism, devil worshipers and law enforcers, experts and victims. They'll help us understand this force that exalts evil and darkness. We'll be asking why. Why does it exist? And why does it appeal to so many vulnerable people, especially the young? Now, the very young and the impressionable should definitely not be watching this program tonight. This is not a Halloween fable. This is a real-life horror story, and it will give small children bad dreams. As for teenagers and their parents, we hope you are watching, because it's teenagers who are most likely to fall under the spell of this jumble of dark, violent emotions called Satanism, and in some cases, to be driven into committing terrible deeds.
You love those warnings and how they keep kids away? Oh, okay. Yeah. watch that then. So anyways, why I'm telling you this. I grew up in the shadow of the Satanic Panic. For some reason, that really resonated with me. I heard these stories, I watched that stuff on the daytime talk shows, and it seemed really horrific to me. I thought that it was true. This was on TV. And I kind of forgot about it, and like a repressed memory. Years later, just at the tail end of high school or something, I started thinking about it again, and I started thinking of, really in that kind of way, like, was I remembering these reports properly? Did they really report these things? And if there was really this kind of satanic mafia just in the underground, whatever happened to this? What was the real story? So I started looking for the Satanists. And I met with people, self-identified Satanists of all stripes, you know, people who were friends with Anton LaVey and the Church of Satan, and I tracked down the Process Church of Final Judgments, at least whatever former members of that organization I could, because it was said that they were really the real Satanists. They were these Luciferians who inspired Charles Manson and the Son of Sam murders and that kind of thing. And what I found was really these kind of, you know, these intelligent people, they still did get caught up in occult life and had their weird communal activities when they were involved in the process. But for the most part, they were very intelligent, very creative, and scared shitless that they would be found out for who they were before because of the panic that surrounded them. They were well aware of the allegations against them. The Church of Satan is a little more buffered from that kind of thing, because the idea is that they could possibly sue, even though they probably won't, because they're kind of just a website by now. But even Geraldo, in 1995, admitted that many innocent people were convicted, went to prison, said that he was positive that recovered memory or repressed therapy movement. It's also a bunch of crap. But it was a bit too late. But in looking for this kind of thing, I found out that it actually still goes on, and still goes on quite a bit. And the Satanic Panic ended when the media stopped taking it seriously, and in general it kind of faded from consciousness. But there's still this kind of underground, not even underground, but there's this fringe, in a way, psychotherapeutic movement that still holds to this idea of repressed memories of trauma. And wherever I find that, I find the most crass conspiracies just in the background. And I went to a conference in, I think it was 2008 or 2009. And the acronym for the organization is SMART, Stop Mind Control and Ritual Abuse Today. And I got there, and the horrifying part of this is that it was actually organized by somebody who holds a license as a mental health counselor. Very ironic, you know. And it was also, some of the speakers also were licensed to actually be in contact with the mentally vulnerable. And there's a table there that was selling electromagnetic beam blocking hats. The proverbial tinfoil hat was actually being sold at this conference. And there's a woman there, she had to have been about 40 years old, and she claimed she was personally abused by Dr. Joseph Mengele, and that he had been using demonic harmonics to open up quantum portals into other realms or something like that. It was really off the charts. It was unbelievable. And you find out that this guy who organizes this conference is also president of another organization called Survivorship, which can offer, or has offered, continuing education credits to therapists. And I start writing about these things, and I get contacted by people all the time who are recent victims of this kind of thing. Their daughters, usually it's females, it's usually daughters, they go into some kind of therapy and they realize that they had been molested all their lives without realizing it, and now they're entirely removed from their families. If you have the time or inclination, look up the Castlewood case, because this is I was a media liaison for this one, and this is how it typically goes nowadays. A settlement is offered, and then the whole thing goes away. Like three or four girls from this eating disorders clinic came to recover these memories of satanic ritual abuse. I don't know if they were all satanic, but they apparently recalled these memories of abuse that they themselves realized weren't true when they came out of the therapy, and they filed suit against Castlewood. Well, Castlewood ultimately offered a big settlement. It goes away. The therapist's responsible. They run off, and it's really tragic because you feel like the state, it shouldn't really even be on them, on the victims to be able to accept the settlement and walk away. I mean, it's difficult to carry through with this kind of thing. It's litigation. This is terrible. It's tedious. But there should be definitely more oversight. Anyways, I start writing about all this, and the accusation immediately becomes that I'm a Satanist. You know, that could be the only reason I care at all about any of it. You know, I'm trying to defend this satanic practice going on in the background. And typically I'd say, but I am not. And I actually felt bad about that, because I felt it was inappropriate. I have met plenty of people who self-identified Satanists. I knew a lot about it. I had quite a bit of background on the whole concept from the witch hunts on up. And I felt like I was conceding something to them when I would say that I'm not a Satanist. Because you're conceding that this thing called Satanism, as they describe it, is somewhere back there in the background, and that you don't want any part of it. You know, that it gives credibility to their claim when you deny it, even. So, that kind of is bringing me some of the way towards doing this whole satanic temple thing. It should be explained that there is no unbroken tradition of Satanism that extends back to biblical times. And in fact, much of what we think we know about Satanism, even imagery-wise, is pretty recent. Some of these things will go back in tomes written by occult historians, and little sketches there that somebody revives later. And that's kind of what happened with the what's called the Baphomet image, the inverted pentagram with the goat head in it. The Church of Satan took that up in the 60s, and then it becomes this kind of primary symbol of Satanism when before it wasn't. Even the idea of the black mass does root back to false allegations again during the affair of the poisons in King Louis's court. There's this whole conspiracy idea that there was a conspiracy of poisoners about, and then it devolved into this idea of Satanism and black mass. But that really meant nothing in the Protestant United States until the fiction stories of Dennis Wheatley came along, quite frankly. And 666 never really held his primacy until as late as The Omen. So this kind of aesthetic body we have, this kind of art and culture, is modern. And I don't think it's any the less so for it. It still resonates with us very much. And I was talking earlier about this kind of cultural divide. I went to speak for the Harvard humanists, and they were all undergraduate. And I don't think they got any of the shock at all. They, you know, the idea of Satanism to them, they're like, well, how do we sign up? You know, Satanism. We talk about doing a 5K run, and they're like, we're there. Q&A, and this was an earlier talk of mine, so I'm expecting, you know, they're going to fire away. Just like, not really. They really liked it. But even in the Bible, several books though it is, we don't really have a consistent story of who Satan is. You have the Book of Job, where he's kind of tossing around with God, and so he's obviously in good standing in God's court, and he says, what about Job? And God says, I don't know, why don't you go fuck with him? We'll just, you know, let's see what happens. And then he does, and it's all him and God playing around. It's not till later that there's this Christian demonology that develops, and you have a real sense of the culture and history and that kind of thing. You can see where it comes from. They had the Jews at that time were having contact with the Iranian Zoroastrians, who viewed everything as this ultimate battle between good and evil. And they developed this kind of apocalyptic doctrine that's not uncommon when you have somebody proclaiming themselves to be the Messiah and is an underdog and all that kind of thing. It's really quite obvious. So the idea of a personal devil, I don't really know where, I don't know which one you'd really actually be adhering to. And also, a lot of the kind of blood libel stories are timeless. And I don't think that there's more credibility to them for being uniform. In fact, I did one talk where when everybody came in and they shuffled in, I had them write down on a 3x5 card the top five most depraved file things they could think of a group of people to do. And they wrote them down, aside from some people trying to be comical. They were fairly uniform. You have cannibalism, incest, you know, murder, you know, different various types. Some people try to be creative with scatological references and everything else. But you'd say this to some of the true believers in the satanic conspiracy, and they would say, well, you know, all these people are telling very similar stories, so clearly something is amiss. And in reality, we have kind of a limited menu of what we consider to be the most depraved things. Otherwise, everybody who came into that room must have undergone this and repressed the memory. It's just not there. You know, it's not difficult to think of what these things are. It's another one of those things that shouldn't really need evidence. But I think also at the time, the 70s and 80s, you're fighting against this kind of blank slate mentality where they didn't realize you can show a snake to a monkey and it will be afraid whether it's ever confronted a snake or not. There's certain things we are inherently disgusted by or whatever. Something we have an innate morality that if you're not psychotic, it resonates with us. But anyways, that's all different topics or various topics. So, but who are self-identified Satanists, and why does that mean anything to them? And I think if you break it down to these very core values, you know, you have the literary Satan, who was constructed by characters like Milton, Byron, and Shelley, in great material. And they didn't believe also in a personal devil, obviously. They were writing these kinds of things in a time where the idea of Satan was kind of put in its proper place, and even clergy, it was distancing itself from it. You know, you come away from these witch hunts and everything else. It kind of waxes and wanes. And at that point, when nobody's taking the literal idea of a personal Satan seriously, you're still left with this excellent artistic raw material that really resonates culturally. And especially for those who reject arbitrary authority, respect personal sovereignty, and have an impulse toward the forbidden. There's this kind of idea of the forbidden, the Satanism. You know, you're looking behind the scenes if you see what it's really about and that kind of thing. And the rejection of arbitrary authority is kind of obvious. If God is symbolic, and I think probably is even for many an atheist, symbolic of tyranny. And Satan is quite the opposite, and quite the defender of the maligned, and those maligned that were set alongside Satan, or Satanized throughout history. And this happened in the United States with the black slaves. So the mythology was that they were worshiping Satan in the background. The Native Americans, it was believed they worshiped Satan. And before that, of course, the Jews were often Satan worshippers. And pagans and the early Christians even were maligned in the same way by the pagans. And throughout all those, you see these common stories of the incest, the cannibalism, and all of those stories from that limited menu. So, anyways, that's kind of what brought me to the Satanic Temple. So it comes to a point where a friend of mine is talking about doing a documentary, and he knows my background with the satanic panic and Satanism in general. And he said, wouldn't it be great if a satanic group actually was just pushing openly for its rights? You know, he said, I would love to do a documentary about that, you know, Satanists, you know, we could just do a documentary, you know, organize this kind of thing. And that's when we started talking about Rick Scott and Rick Scott in Florida. This was not much more than a year ago, actually. Rick Scott in Florida, the governor over there, had pushed through the Senate bill, Senate Bill 98. It allowed for inspirational messages in schools. It essentially allowed for prayer in school. And we thought, well, wouldn't that be something if some minority religious group took advantage of that, because in a Judeo-Christian culture where the religious message is taken for granted of what this will be, this could be a boom for religious diversity, when you have another group saying, well, these kids would commonly never learn of us at all, but now Rick Scott, this great American, has opened this door for us in the name of religious pluralism. So we filed to hold a rally, and it was approved. And then we were obligated to go, and that was my first indication of the kind of publicity we would get. But here's a good clip from Martin Bashir.
Florida Governor Rick Scott has managed to alienate just about every voter in his state. In fact, he was so unpopular, Mitt Romney chose to avoid him throughout the presidential campaign. And yet, his administration's policies, which include purging voter rolls, drug testing welfare recipients, and warehousing disabled children in nursing homes, have shown signs of support amongst one notable but often overlooked demographic. Satanists. Yes, the Satanic Temple of Florida is organizing a rally next week to support Mr. Scott for signing a 2012 law that essentially would allow student-led prayer in school. We spoke to one of the Satanists today about why they support the law. Lucien Greaves, and yes, that is the name the gentleman gave us, told us that the law would prevent the marginalization of Satanism and other smaller religious groups and lead to, quote, a boom in religious diversity. Yes, Rick Scott, champion of diversity. It does seem hard to believe, but in the spirit of New Year generosity, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. Because if Rick Scott, even by accident, is now a supporter of diversity, then we say, hail Rick Scott. Stay with us. The day's top lines are coming up.
What was fun about that is Rick Scott is such an asshole. And so the press was talking to me quite a bit, and they kept asking me if I had heard anything from Rick Scott. I kept saying, no, let me know what he says. And they kept hammering on him to the point where he finally did make a statement, and he just said something like, oh, isn't America great? Everybody has a voice. Or you don't actually see his face at the time, but I like to imagine a tear in his eye. And we got to Rick Scott again earlier this year. We were contacted by people in Florida, people we actually had met up with during this Rick Scott rally. And they said, hey, there's a nativity scene in the Capitol Rotunda. And we said, okay, do what you will. And they did their own Satanic Temple diorama thing that we approved of. We filled out the paperwork and applied for it and all of that. And you probably know that they had allowed in the Capitol Rotunda, you probably heard this story, it was a good atheist story. They allowed the Festivus pole and another atheist display. So we thought ours would kind of get lost in the mire or whatever. Oh, Flying Spaghetti Monster was there. So by the time our guys actually built the thing, we thought, well, this one's already dead. But they said no to us, so we were thrilled. We couldn't believe it. And you could tell in the press that there was a good deal of disappointment from the atheists and the Pastafarians and that kind of thing. It was, well, why them? Why not us? You can see on certain sites, if you read the comments, that it was starting to dawn on these people that what we were doing, I think, was far more poignant, you know, because it speaks to their own narrative in a way that says we're going to take control of it ourselves and use it how we will. You know, we're taking it in a different direction. And plus, we have that kind of aesthetic body that people recognize. And people recognize satanic symbolism, modern as it might be, as satanic. And it's a whole new game then. I don't think Pastafarianism is nearly the same message. It doesn't resonate the same way, though I do support that as well. Anyways, ultimately the ACLU wrote a strongly worded letter to the Florida Commission. They had said that our display was grossly offensive. And before jumping to anything, we just said, if you can give us any tangible kind of community standards that our display violates, we'll be happy to change it. Any pre-existing tangible deviations from it. And they didn't reply. So I thought we kind of had a slam dunk suit there, that the ACLU wrote them a strong word letter, and I don't know where we're at with that right now. The monument thing really started up in that time frame. So as far as I know, the lawyer's still going to be pursuing that one. Definitely the idea is that they can't deny us next time, for sure, because it seems like an issue at the time they turned us down is that it was already said and done. You know, the displays were coming down, the holiday was over, we were a little late on the trial. But anyways, after the Rick Scott thing, we thought we wanted more Satanism active in a productive way in the community. So we're going to do an Adopt a Highway program in New York. Put together a little promo video to get people to adopt a highway in New York. And we were near rolling that out, I think, when the Boston Marathon bombing happened. And that's where I am. And I don't know if you've been to Boston, but it's actually very small as far as cities go. From Detroit, it's 143 square feet of nothing. But Boston's very compact, so everything's kind of local. So, you know, the bombing happens, it affects everybody. You know, that kind of descent into the martial law, and everything that was, you know, apparent from my rooftop, you know, helicopters all day, and it was crazy. And then you had the Westboro Baptist Church come along, and they wanted to picket the funerals of the victims of the bombing, because, of course, gay marriage did this, or whatever. Somehow it all came down to gays being allowed to exist, and they wanted to make a big thing of it in Boston. And so I thought, well, you know, we as the Satanic Temple should try to meet up with the Westboro Baptist Church when they come here. So we went there, and the Westboro Baptist Church didn't show up. I think I have an image of what they tweeted. Maybe I don't. Oh yeah, this was a little meme that I think was inspired by our Rick Scott thing. Prayer in school, be careful what you wish for. Oh yeah, that was from the Rick Scott rally too. That's kind of my iconic satanic Nixon. Oh yeah, so instead of actually showing up, the Westboro Baptist Church tweeted this image of one of their hags floating above the crowd in Boston with these signs, "Fags, doom nations, and God sent the bombs," and tweeted with the message, "You showed up for us and we're there in your hearts." And so the question to us became, how can we be there for them in their hearts? So we decided to contrive our own satanic ritual, which we decided to call the Pink Mass, in which we get two same-sex couples to do a gay love ceremony above the gravestone of the founder of the Westboro Baptist Church. Not his grave, his mother's grave. He's still alive. So we found his mother's grave, and we went there, and we, you know, we got these pictures and did this press release and had these people kissing above the grave. And that was yet another time I thought, we're not going to get, I didn't really think that would get the kind of press it did. It got a lot of press. And as I was telling Herb earlier, we had gotten done with this thing and we went to a restaurant in Mississippi. It's just this little town. There's not a whole lot going on there. And then we went in there and the bartender noticed we were from out of town. And he said, "What are you all doing here? What's going on? You working on a film or something?" I guess we seem like that type. And everybody was just, they didn't know what to say. And I said, "No, we're with the Satanic Temple. We just went and did a gay love satanic cemetery ritual at the grave of the mother of the founder of the Westboro Baptist Church. And he didn't believe me at all. And he was laughing about it. And then later I was getting these emails from people in Mississippi, and they're saying, the townsfolk are in an uproar. If you come here, they will kill you. And I thought, I wonder about that guy. What he was thinking, because he just laughed it off, and then you've probably seen these news reports and saying, good God, actually true. But this is my favorite news report. This here kind of makes it all worth it.
Police are vowing to file charges against members of a New York church accused of trespassing at a local cemetery. Tonight, the other violations police say were committed. Good evening to you at 6 o'clock. I'm Chip Scarborough. Well, the owner of a Meridian cemetery has already said he plans to pursue charges against members of New York's Satanic Temple. And now police are investigating the unusual ritual that was performed there and preparing to make arrests. Candace Barnett has more on where the investigation stands now.
We brought you the story of the Satanic Temple's trip to a Meridian cemetery that's gaining national attention. Now the cemetery owner is looking to press charges, and the police are preparing to make an arrest.
Meridian police have reached out and spoken to Mr. Arlinghouse of Magnolia Cemetery. We are in the process now of constructing affidavits and warrants against these individuals, and we will have them arrested as soon as we can.
A group from New York's Satanic Temple made the trip to Meridian to protest the Westboro Baptist Church. You can see from pictures on their website, there they performed a ritual they call Pink Mass on the grave of Katherine Johnston, the mother of Westboro founder Fred Phelps Jr. The ceremony involved two same-sex couples kissing over her grave. They then declared Katherine Johnston a lesbian in the afterlife.
It is an unusual thing that we haven't come across, to my knowledge, in a while. Not only does it violate a state and city ordinance, but it also violates the moral decency of human beings.
Their actions are instead meant to convey a message of love in the face of hate, celebrating gay love, since the Westboro Baptist Church has become famous for its intolerance of homosexuals. The Satanic Temple encourages others to hold their own pink masses in the cemetery, but the owner says he'll be on the lookout.
They are not welcome to perform disrespectful ceremonies. I don't want to give them overly too much attention, because that's really what they're trying to see.
And the Satanic Temple admits attention is what they're after. They hope their actions will draw attention to the organization's efforts to raise money to participate in New York City's Adopt a Highway program.
We will keep the highway clear of litter and debris. We ask for your help in contributing to the Satanic Temple's efforts.
Captain Harper says the MPD has plenty of evidence to arrest these individuals. They'll be looking at charges for trespassing, indecent exposure, and malicious mischief at a minimum. Candace Barnett, News Center 11.
Now the Satanic Temple has currently raised just over $1,000 of its $15,000 goal for the Adopt a Highway program.
Yeah, it seemed to me kind of funny that it seemed like they were implying that the deeper, more sinister plot behind this cemetery ceremony was that we were raising money to adopt the highway.
I like that he let everyone know how far into your goal you were there.
Oh yeah, they always did that with the monument thing too. That's why the monument thing was kind of harrowing to me, because we did put up a crowdsourcing option where we set a goal for $20,000, and I thought everybody's going to be judging us on where this stands. When we far exceeded that goal, I was very happy about that, because on Indiegogo you see not only how much money is raised, but how many people have contributed. And earlier on Fox News, we would have these characters saying, well, you know what, you probably have like only two guys who want this monument to go up. And then kind of killed that. Well, actually they didn't. They don't look at that stuff anymore. They didn't do any research. But the pink mass thing was fun. it generated its own kind of controversy. There was other people who claimed to be Satanists who said, hey, there's no such thing as a pink mass. And I thought that was funny too.
I take it you didn't get arrested?
No, I couldn't see them actually extraditing me on those charges, but it does lead me to the quote. I just had to put this in the presentation because I have to give myself credit for probably the best quote in an article ever. When Feist was asking me about the pink mass and whether I was worried about actually getting arrested, and I said, "We caused no material damage to anything, and the cemetery was left exactly as it was when we entered it. I'm not sure which part of this is most problematic for the sheriff, the displays of homosexuality or the Satanism. I do know that the combination of the two is bound to cause absolute havoc amongst the superstitious homophobic." And even though I was clear in my interviews, I would say that we actually we were in an entire revolt against supernaturalism. And we don't actually believe we've turned her into a lesbian in the afterlife. I would explain that we felt that due to Fred Phelps's own untenable, ridiculous, superstitious beliefs, we believe that he was obligated to believe that his mother was gay in the afterlife. And our belief was inviolable to the point that he couldn't tell us otherwise. We believe that he believes his mother is gay in the afterlife. He can't say anything about it. And that is kind of a mockery of their own position, which they took all the way to the Supreme Court, that it's all about belief and nobody can say what they believe and their belief is inviolable and everything else. But anyways, that didn't make for a good, that was too confusing for the press for the most part. But he asked if there were any rituals I could do to the sheriff if he was going to pursue me. And I said, "I predict that if I were to be arrested and extradited to Mississippi, my very presence would raise unholy psychological hell amongst the sheriff and his colleagues. Just as medieval demon panics gave rise to episodes in which repressed people took the opportunity to act out in mindless abandon, exonerated from their own deeds by the idea of possession, I believe it quite possible that I could find myself in a holding cell witnessing the Meridian police devolve into a sweaty, grunting, savage orgy of uncaged all influenced by the idea that they were utterly powerless against my sexual conversion magic. Perhaps they were merely looking for such a scapegoat." Yeah, I definitely don't want to get arrested in Mississippi. But if I had to pick one of the 50 states to cut out. But then the next move was the monument thing. And that was kind of an idea we had at the inception with the Rick Scott thing. We knew the issue that there are several places where there have been, they have a lot of the Ten Commandments monument in the public square. The thing is, you need standing. You need somebody to be there. You know, you need somebody to be able to say that they support what you're doing if you're going to be able to put a monument there. We're pretty new, you know, we have people coming in. So we are looking up to match up new membership with an area where we had knowledge that there would be a Ten Commandments monument or whatever else. So we had a member in Oklahoma, and she apprised us of the situation there, and it seemed perfect. And ultimately, she didn't sign on for us. We, you know, some other people in Oklahoma began emailing and said it whichever way they could help. And this was when the publicity was already pretty intense. So having your name and address on a public document was kind of a lot to ask. So everybody was saying, "If somebody else can do it, they'll do it." So we just, you know, emailed somebody at that point, and they were willing to sign up. But in any case, the thing that made Oklahoma perfect, really, is that the situation there with their Ten Commandments monument was that there's a Baptist minister, Mike Ritz, who's also a representative in the legislature over there, who pushed to be able to put his Ten Commandments monument with his own name on it and everything else. And it grossly misspelled, I guess, certain words when it first came up. That was a big news story. But the Oklahoma decided they would allow this privately donated Ten Commandments monument, and they said it was a historical document, or they might have just changed that argument to say at some point after we applied, I don't know. But they said, well, it's private, and the ACLU was pressing suit, and the state, that the Attorney General, I believe, was saying at the time that it was kind of a moot point because they envisioned this area of the Capitol to be, in the future, something of a monument park. So the door was open. They they didn't respond well to our initial dispatch saying that we'd like to present one ourselves, a monument. And then we started seeing all these new claims about the Ten Commandments and about how the Ten Commandments are allowed there at the Capitol because they have a unique place in American history. That these were the foundations of American law. And of course, the thing was is maybe they shouldn't have played their hand so soon because we hadn't even worked out our design yet. So I was able to take that into account when building for a historical argument. But it's also easy to argue against that idiotic rhetoric because does anybody need to be told that nowhere in constitutional law or any state law, for that matter, is our tenets like thou shalt have no God before me, or thou shalt keep the Sabbath holy, or not worship graven idols. None of it's in there. They always like to bring up these universal morals like thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, and that kind of thing. But these are things that aren't in the Constitution either, because they don't need to be. You know, these are things we quite know, and it's insulting to think that these tablets made us realize this.
While religious conservatives are making their voices heard across America, other religious groups are also trying to have their voices heard. And that includes Satanists.
Well, in the buckle of the Bible Belt, this seems maybe a little hard to believe, but a satanic monument erected next to the Ten Commandments at the state capitol. It could happen.
And a Satanic Temple member says the state government brought this upon itself because putting up the Ten Commandments in the first place makes a religious statement.
Erected just over a year ago, this Ten Commandments monument stands at the north end of the state capitol. But at these steps, a satanic temple wants what it calls equality.
The Satanists came along and said, hey, well, if you get your Ten Commandments statue or monument, we get our Satanist monument.
You kidding me now? Are we making a mockery of everything with regard to Christianity in this society? Now we're going to have a satanic monument next to the Ten Commandments, really?
Unfortunately for civil libertarians, this type of sort of activist move by Satanists is going to be a lot more effective than all the legal jawboning over the First Amendment you could possibly do.
Let me speak to the Satanic Temple of New York. Let me speak to you directly, gentlemen. You're making a big mistake.
We don't see a way that the state can then deny other religions, whether it's Satanism, whether it's Judaism, Islam, Catholicism, Hindu, Buddhist, whatever. We don't think the state can pick and choose.
You've got to agree with the rabbi, do you not, that this is absolutely a mockery and ridiculous?
Absolutely, not mockery, not ridiculous. The separation of church and state is what makes America great. Religious freedom means the government doesn't take sides, one religion or another. You may not like the Satanists, guess what? That doesn't matter.
So it's sort of a variation on the, if the state is going to allow the Christians to have, you know, if we're going to bust the wall of separation between church and state, then let's let multiple religions in, including the folks who are the Satanists.
You don't want to dare set your little idol God next to the Word of God.
All right, why can't Satanists do it?
By the word religion in the First Amendment, the founders meant Christianity.
Let's be absolutely emphatic. This is ridiculous. It's not just that it's a mockery. It actually demeans America.
Last crowd that tried that was in the Temple of Dagon.
The founders were thinking of Christianity, so the purpose was to protect the free exercise of the Christian faith. It wasn't about protecting anything else.
Our monument alongside the Ten Commandments monument sends a strong and direct message, and that message is one more in line, I think, with our American values of inclusiveness and equality in the eyes of the law.
They themselves started growing cancerous tumors on their genitals. And after 7 months, they gave the Word of God back. I promise you, if you go down to Oklahoma and put a statue of the devil next to the Word of God, you don't want to know what's coming up.
Almost like they went to the craziest group they could find. No offense.
I want to shift gears a little bit, and I want to talk about Santa Claus.
Hey,
Yeah, so everybody was going wild, and we hadn't even released what the monument was supposed to be yet, which wasn't really expected. I thought we would get that kind of response later, like if an actual legal battle started, or once Oklahoma actually replied to us. So it kind of caught me a little off guard, and we hadn't set up the crowdsourcing yet, which I did right away, and then we had to hurry up and put together this this design. But I was on a Huffington Post panel. They had legal scholars on and me, and they were talking about this monument issue. And it was really helpful because they were really keying me in on the arguments that were going to be used. And I didn't actually think of the historical argument. I think, well, it's self-evident, right? You have the Ten Commandments, it's historical. Satanism, it's just as historical, you know, but they were talking about this idea about how the Ten Commandments helped form our laws. So this ultimately was the design. Yeah, you have a couple of cherubic little children, and you have what's known as Baphomet. Now, Baphomet, this kind of image, this, you might be familiar with something similar. It was elaborated by this occult historian, Eliphas Levi, in the 19th century. This goat-headed, hermaphroditic character with the caduceus at its lap, and as above, so below, the wings. And but the word Baphomet comes from earlier in the heresy trials of the Templars in the 12th century. And the Templars were crusaders who were accused of heresy, so the Pope and the King at the time could seize their land and assets. And it was said that they were worshipping an idol called Baphomet. There was all these standard run-of-the-mill accusations of cannibalism, murder, whatever else, the same old litany. But it was said they were worshipping an idol called Baphomet, and that word almost certainly comes from Mahomet, Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. So it's just the Satanized outgroup of the time. You know, it's the same for the Native Americans, the black slaves, the Jews, whatever else. So I felt like Baphomet as this kind of construct of this occult historian's imagery, and this the naming was kind of a perfect image of the unjustly outcast, maligned outgroup that now has a voice, you know, being set next to the Ten Commandments. It would symbolize that entirely. And my argument from the legal aspect was that it was stronger than the Ten Commandments, because it was by this trial and error, by these witch hunts, these kinds of activities, that we developed a respect for secular law. Even in places that are mostly religious, you know, in areas where citizenry is religious, there's oftentimes, we hope, respect for secular law. And the presumption of innocence and a respect for material evidence removed from supernatural notions, hopefully, or, you know, in the United States, we eschew symbolic crimes, blasphemy, that kind of speech, thought crimes, that kind of thing. So that was my historical argument for that. I think it's a strong one. And since then, there's been various other arguments employed, which I'm not really interested in until this actually goes to court, which it probably will. Unless they just let us put it up. So. So, since the monument thing is the big issue, and I think most people probably have questions about that, I'll cut it off there. And let people do their Q&A and ask me questions. It doesn't have to be about that. But I hope I made clear why I talked so much about the Satanic Panic earlier on. I was having difficulty on how to transition this and make it all tie together. But for me, it's deeply important that we don't tolerate this kind of witch-hunting mentality that's always prevalent. This kind of supernatural thinking, this kind of conspiracy theory thinking, that creates outgroups of innocent people and destroys their lives. And I think that's the deeper mission for the Satanic Temple in general, behind all the all the tomfoolery and laughing about him. So, anyways, Q&A.